Now, for some final thoughts about the structure of words. We've seen that there are rules of word formation of various sorts, and that there are combinations of morphemes that go together, that prefixes require their stems to come after them, and so forth, and that enables us to make a distinction between existing and non-existing words and possible and impossible words. Lexical items, the things that are in your mental dictionary and in other people's mental dictionaries, are existing words. So a lexeme is not necessarily an existing word. It's just a word in general. A lexical item is an existing word, part of the lexicon of the language and stored in the mental lexica of its speakers. But there are clearly non-existing words as well, words that nobody has currently got stored in their mental dictionaries. These are lexemes. They are words in the abstract sense, but they happen not to exist. Let's suppose that we make up internationalizability. It's okay. It meets all the requirements of an English word. Its morphemes are in the right order and so forth, but I suspect it doesn't exist in the lexicon of any particular native speaker. Although, of course, if you say it often enough and remember it, then maybe it will exist. But there are words that are well formed, that are possible. The word loveliness, for example, is certainly a possible word. It may also be an existing word, but whether it's possible or not has to do with whether it meets the rules of word formation. In this case, it does. There are other words that are not well formed and therefore impossible. Here's an example of a word that just isn't a possible English word. And it's an interesting question, why not? Loveliness is fine. Why isn't slowliness okay? Well, let's have a look at which rules are involved. Ness goes on the end of what? The rule for attaching ness says that it must come on the end of adjectives. Lovely is an adjective. Slowly, however, is not an adjective, it's an adverb, and ness doesn't go on the end of adverbs. We haven't actually said much about adverbs, but this is an adverb. So, slowliness is an impossible word. Doesn't mean we can't talk about it, but it couldn't be a word of English. Now let's put all this to use very quickly in looking at style. When you use a language, when anybody uses a language, they select certain kinds of words and not other kinds of words, and that's indicative of a style that you adopt. And authors are particularly sensitive to the kinds of styles that they use. So what we've learnt about morphemes can be put to use in gaining an understanding of the kind of style that an author is producing from selecting particular kinds of morphemes. Here are two extracts. We're going to look at the kinds of morphemes that there are and see what it has to tell us about the author's style. I was away for 2 days at the posts. When I got home, it was too late, and I did not see Miss Barclay until the next evening. She was not in the garden, and I had to wait in the office of the hospital until she came down. Well, where are the morphemes? Well, there's an awful lot of free morphemes. There are not a lot of bound morphemes. Where are they? Where are they? Well, there's the odd past tense, but not in the form of a morpheme. Come and came. Had. This is a passage with no derivational morphology at all. There are almost no complex words here. In other words, the morphology is very simple. The author has tried to choose vocabulary which suggests that this isn't complex in terms of its style. And this is by Ernest Hemingway. Hemingway wanted to sound simple, and so he chose a morphology which enabled him to do so. Here's another passage. The author of these essays is so sensible of their defects that he has repeatedly refused to let them appear in a form which might seem to indicate that he thought them worthy of a permanent place in English literature. Nor would he now give his consent to the republication of pieces so imperfect if, by withholding his consent, he could make republication impossible. Well, the vocabulary of this passage, the style, is also relatively simple. But there are quite a few more derivational endings. Repeatedly, ly on the end, republication, imperfect, withholding, impossible. There are a few more, and yet it sounds a lot more complicated. It's not just the vocabulary, of course, the grammar is also more complicated. This is a piece by Thomas Babington Macaulay, and is a 19th century piece of prose. If you are interested in the study of literature, one of the ways in which you can get a handle on an author's style is by looking in detail at their morphology. There are authors that attempt the simplest possible style by trying to eradicate particularly derivational morphology, choosing simple native words with no complications. Of course, you can't avoid inflectional morphology. That's necessary, it's part of the structure of the language, whereas you can often avoid derivational morphology if you like. You can quite often avoid compound words if you work at it. So style is able to be studied through an author's morphology.